Now, we are going to start the historical struggle or the struggles around the world. Let us first start with Europe. When we talk about Europe, we need to have a specific identity, a country called France. There is a saying also, if France sneezes, Europe gets cold. The concept is, if any issue which starts at France initially, its effect is being felt all around the Europe. So if France will sneeze, the Europe will get cold. It's like a nose for the entire Europe, where once it gets affected, everything gets affected. So now let us try to understand what is the French Revolution and how did the concept of nationalism emerged out in Europe. So the concept is rise of nationalism in Europe. This is the first unit of history which we are going to start now. The rise of nationalism in Europe. What is the word of the meaning of the word nation first of all? We are trying to understand what is nationalism in Europe. How did the nationalism got up, evolved in Europe? So let us try to understand what is the meaning of the word nation. Nation is a group of people living together who share a common land, who live together, who follow the same language, same culture, same identity. These people are together known as nation. So, a group of people who share same culture, language, place, etc. can be called as a nation. The place may be called as a nation. Then what is nationalism? The feeling of attachedness towards a particular nation or feeling pursuit towards that nation is called nationalism. So it's a feeling who have a common language, common religion, common boundaries, common things are called as, will provoke them to have the feeling of nationalism. This can be understood like this. A state of belongingness towards a nation or an ethnic group. So, the belongingness, the feeling, as I told you earlier, the feeling or the belongingness towards a particular nation or being associated with something makes them to get the rise of nationalism. If you are not connected with your nation, you do not have the feeling of nationalism or patriotism. So this is understanding of the main point what we are going to discuss in Europe. So in Europe, Europe itself is a continent. In Europe, we have many countries together. So in Europe, out of many countries, how can you understand the facts of Europe? Or like how different nations have influenced their struggles towards the other nations to come towards the struggles. So that's something which started in France, which spread entirely towards the Europe. First, our attention will be towards France. Then we shall move on how it got spread down. So when we talk about the French issue, French is the official language spoken by the people of France. So, before discussing about the French issue, we shall look at the pictures which are given in the page 1. The page 1 pictures will reveal for us the facts. What happened is Frederick Sarrieux. Frederick Sarrieux has made 4 paintings. In which he expressed the feeling of nation states, republic and social rights, belonging to one group or one nation. Statue of Liberty, so in his paintings he tried to portray the scenes which he dreamed of to be have in Europe. He initially had a dream where he portrayed that all the people of Europe are merging towards the Statue of Liberty, where the Statue of Liberty is standing with a torch on the light showing the way to the people. On the other hand, it's hanging the rights of the individuals. So he wants the people to understand that they have future when they have the rights. He wants them to understand clearly that there is certain limitation of the existing system. He had a huge dream of social and republican governments. He had the ideology of socialism. There should not be any kind of discrimination. There should not be any restricted power houses, or there should not be a family which holds the entire power thoroughly. These all things have to be changed. That is the meaning of the words what he have used, like social, republic, nation states, where he want a new group of nations to turn up, where he don't want the kingdoms to be in existence. He want the leaders to be removed off. He want the new systems to be coming in. He want the systematic governance to be happening. So all these words which he has used belong to one nation, the nationalism, the rights which are holded by the Statue of Liberty according to him. He made the Statue of Liberty to be a female figure, and his dream was to have a nation state where the people are the supreme people, where people have the right to govern themselves. These all are the hidden things. And he, on his own paintings, he also had a vision of angels coming and blessing the people who are having these kind of ideas and the ideologies. These are the, some of the pictures which depict for us, which were drawn in 1848 by Mr. Frederick Sarrieux in his series of 4 paintings. Now, let us understand what actually happened in the French Revolution. Then we shall move on to the developments of the concepts of nationalism, then the turning of the faces of French Revolution, then we shall move on to the other aspects. So the main focus on this lesson is the French Revolution, The French Revolution was initially had an absolute monarchy. You all know what is the meaning of absolute monarchy. Absolute monarchy is a term which is used to explain the authorities of a power of a particular person who is running the government, and whose words are final. There is no more authority above him to go and appeal there. So this kind of authoritative person who is heading the government is known as absolute monarch. That too when he is from a royal family and he is king, these words are appropriate. So in France we had the absolute monarchic system in existence till the year 1789. Once the revolt broke out in 1789, the people have marched out of their houses, walked onto the streets, blasted the Bastille Palace, made the king to run away from there, and they decided we did not go for absolute monarchic system further. We would go for our own governance of body of active citizens. So they decided to have body of active citizens. The body of active citizens means here that the people who are actually facing problems will be the part and parcel of the system of governance. They do not want somebody from a royal family will be dictating them what to do and what not to do. But it would be better for them that if the same people who are really facing problems, who are in the scenario, would be there present. So they decided to have the body of active citizens who will plan and further shape the future of the nation. So their duty is to shape the future of the nation. So when you talk about the shaping the future of the nation, what do they do? What do they want to do actually? They want to have a uniformity of laws. There should not be any discrimination to anybody. There is a new concept emerging outside like equality. There should be equality for everybody. This land belongs to everybody. Everybody belongs to the same country. There is no discrimination of based on the richness and the poorness. So they brought the word called la patrie, meaning fatherland. La patrie meaning fatherland. So the la patrie meaning fatherland means that this land belongs to everybody, especially those who belong to that particular nation. And they also brought the concept of lis citium, means citizenship. Citizens, you are the people or the citizens of this nation. Your fatherland is this. They also brought a new tricolor flag. Tricolor flag, which is clear that this flag is a symbolization of a new nation to be emerging outside. They also renamed the elected representatives as the government for themselves. So they renamed the existing system. They changed the names. They brought new patterns. They brought new hymns, new songs, and the martyrs who have sacrificed their lives in the struggle of the freedom to get this structure. So they commemorated, the martyrs were commemorated, the new hymns were sung, the language which are spoken regionally, which are having the regional dialectics, were being discarded. French, which is spoken in Paris, the Paris, the capital of France, has been made the official language of the French. So these all aspects made it very clear for the people that we need to understand this very clearly. The change of a pattern of the existing system from the absolute monarchy to the elected representatives, the new government coming, stepping in, rather than replacing the existing things. And the citizens were made very active. People started to participate very actively in the system. They also decided that this awakening should happen for every nation in the Europe. So they literally want every nation, the Europe, to have different nations, different nationalities to be coming up in Europe. The concept of nationalism should emerge in Europe. These ideologies made it very clear. That is the reason why it is rightly known as when France sneezes, Europe gets cold. So the revolution first started in France. It started to spread to all the countries in Europe. It spread to Germany, it spread to Italy, it spread to Hungary, it spread to Austria. So it started to spread on to all the countries, Poland, Czechoslovakia. All these countries started to turn up towards the existing system. They started to think on the lines of French Revolution. The concept of equality, the concept of citizenship, the ideology of nationalism, has been spreading up in all the countries of Europe. So this is not a one day process. And French Revolution people always they thought that we need to advocate this ideology to all people, then only this ideology can be spread to various other people and they all can come under the categorization of the different nations rather than coming under the different kingdoms. So this was the initial understanding of French Revolution. So as we have an initial idea of the French Revolution brought the government of National Assembly coming into existence. So after the National Assembly has come into existence, the citizens were recognized to be equal. There is no any kind of discrimination based on them. They were made active citizens. So after this has been done, initially for a period of 1 year, in 1790s, the Jacobins clubs were being established all around the France, and secretly a revolution came which took over the ruling in 1791 by the Jacobin group's leader Robespierre. So after Robespierre has taken away the rule, he tried his level best to bring the discriminations to completely an end. He regulated the market prices, he reduced the prices, and he maintained strictly order that any kind of wheat other than the good quality should not be sold in the market, and that too not in a very high extent. It should be at the reach of a common man. So these all steps made him very clear, and most of the people started to like his administration in the initial days. But later he started to eliminate the people, those who are not supporting to his ideas and the ideologies. So this he started to have a machine called guillotine, in which we have a machine structure which is designed to behead the person. So later in 1793 he himself was being beheaded because of the extremism which he has expressed in making his rules and regulations and making the people to follow these all these things, initiated to a larger scale of dissatisfaction among the people. So once his turn has been off, we are in a situation where the term has come to a directory rule. In the directory rule, where instead of one person having the entire control, the four different groups, the Napoleons, the Bonaparte groups, and the people, those who are revolutionary groups, those who are constitutional groups, these all people came to force and they formed the government, where instead of in one person hand, we have a directory government rule. So in this directory government rule, where the initially we have representatives from all the parties taking over and running it into existence. But as the time passed on, the mission of French Revolution, when initially people decided that we will wage wars, we will make it to grow an extent and bring the nations in Europe rather than kingdoms in Europe. So in 1790, when Napoleon was made the brigadier general of the army, and he waged wars against Italy, Switzerland, Belgium, Holland, all these countries, they were very much happy and they welcomed the armies with a greater excitement. They were considered as the harbingers of freedom, or harbingers of the human relationship, harbingers of the nationalism. The people, those who initiate the process, those who start the process, those who are very much associated with this one. So this made the people to welcome the armies of French initially. The Napoleon in 1799 has taken over the dictatorship rule, I mean like the constitutional monarchy, he turned to be a complete monarch. So the era of Napoleon, so after Robespierre we have the directory rule. So after the situation's turned, we have Napoleon. Napoleon, absolutely, after he became the emperor, he has shed aside the democratic structure of France. This is a fact. We need to agree here. But though he had brought the rule of democracy into end, but he initiated the process of having a proper structure, and he brought certain rules and regulations known as civil code. in the year 1804. This is also famous as Napoleonic Code. So according to the rules, code is a connect of rules. According to these rules, he or she is a free citizen. There is no kind of any discrimination based on any citizens. There is no financial disparity between anybody. And all the people have to follow certain rules and regulations. This made it very clear that concept of equality. So not only this, he had simplified the administrative structure. He had freed the peasants. From serfdom and manorial dues. He simplified the administration. Reduced the taxes. New tax system. So when the peasants were freed from their regular bondageness of working under some royal family or the relatives of the royal group or the manor lords, and they were forced like a beggar to work without much of the payments paid, this was been completely waived out. And the next major thing what he has done, he has waived out all the dues of all the people those are working under them. There is no person to check you or tell you like you are having a due with this particular monarch. So these all changes have initiated to a greater success to the Napoleon initially. And he also brought a systematized administrative structure. He simplified everything. Initially, we used to have 39 states and the tax collection system unit is called as Jalavaran, where you need to pay at 11 places different taxes. Minimum 5% of the customs duty if you want to cross all these regions and go to the other side. But Napoleon changed all these things. Napoleon changed the entire taxation pattern. He reduced the taxes from 60% to 10 to 15%. He brought a new initiative. The businessmen, the small and the large business people were able to happily experience the new patterns, the system. And he made everybody equal. The opportunities are provided equally. There is no certain kind of discrimination based on any grounds. So this initial process and abolition of the serfdom, abolition of any kind of discriminations, and abolition of any kind of dues, and he also abolished the feudal system. So he abolished the feudal system, which is a very, very large and a major step what he has taken. These all steps made him really welcome in all the other countries like Holland, Belgium, Switzerland, all these countries. But because of his steps of stepping in and changing the administration, which was already welcomed by all the people, but the taxation system, which made the French people to do more and more wars in order to get more and more land under their control, so that the taxation would be added for them and they would have certain amount of money under the court, the royal court. So in order to maintain the economic balance, we need to wage wars. And these wars are at the cost of others' interest. So when initially Napoleon was considered as a crusader for them, who will provide every opportunity for them to develop. So in Brussels, in Milan, various other places, his army was welcomed with great enthusiasm, with great expectations. People were very happy with the system, the patterns are going on. The administrative reforms are really very good, very successful. But it is not going in hand with the political freedoms. The administrative things are going very well designed. But the political freedoms are being curbed for them. What are the political freedoms? What that being stopped for them initially were? The censorship has been imposed on them. There is no right to talk against any of the rulers or the dictators. Obviously, censorship has been imposed. Later on, we can understand this like taxation increased and forced conscription into French army. So the censorship, anyway, it was being a block on the freedom of the people. But when it comes to taxation increased, so initially you mentioned like the taxation of different 60%, 11 taxes have been reduced and brought into one tax. Yes, this taxation has been brought in France, where initially we used to have 11 different types of taxes that has to be paid from when we pass from capital to the other regions. They were all cancelled, single taxation was brought, single currency has been issued. But as when it comes to the other states, when they were occupying the other states, there they used to collect more taxes. There are more censorship on the activities of the people. Everything is being checked properly. And third point is the very, very important point, which changed the mindset of the people. Forcefully, they used to conscriptate them or make them to join in the French army. Sir, why they need to join the other country people into the French army? Why? Because here he want a large army in order to redraw the map of France, redraw the control of the French region. Napoleon want to have control on the other regions of Europe. So this idea of Napoleon itself brought a trouble for the people who are in Belgium, who are in the other countries of Brussels, Italy, Milan, all the other regions, where they initially they felt that he would come here and bring nationalism spirit to us and give freedom for us. But he is coming here, occupying our land, squeezing our wealth and forcing us to join into the French army to fight the other countries. This has been subsiding the administrative achievements what Napoleon has achieved and which people have appreciated initially. But these administrative changes were not going in surpass with the political freedom, where they are going in opposite directions, which raised the anger of the people, and this brought dissatisfaction towards the French armies in the people of Austria, Holland, Belgium, Switzerland, all the other countries. So how did the nationalism or making of nationalism emerge in Europe? Leaving apart the French Revolution concept, now we'll try to understand how was the actual working of French Revolution's impact on the other nations fellow. So after the French Revolution has impacted, we have seen how the people are being changing their attitude towards the Napoleon's rule. We already have discussed how the systems are going on in respect to Napoleon's code and conduct. We already know that autocratic regimes or autocratic monarchies are present. How is the concept of nationalism spreading in Europe? What are the factors that led to the spread of nationalism in Europe? Let us think in the practical terms, or let us find out what actually is happening in Europe. Europe can be broadly categorized into two parts, Eastern Europe, Western Europe. So after categorizing Eastern Europe and Western Europe, you can see that there are autocratic monarchies present here. Autocratic monarchies are the monarchies who have come with the arbitrary rule of the family hierarchy, and monarchy itself gives a clear picture for us that they are coming from the hierarchy line. They are not at all in the favor or interest of the people. And next one, they are not having any collective identity. The collective identity means here that they do not follow any common language, common culture, common pattern of religion or anything else. But still, they are bound. Only the reason is because they are having common allegiance to an emperor. They are controlled by a large and mighty powerful emperor. So under his control only they are working. Other than that, there is no common element which is binding them together. And it's not only the case with Eastern and the Western of Europe. We have many countries also. In specific, if you take the Austria and Hungary, which are under the control of the Habsburg family. Austria has a different set of culture and pattern. Hungary had a different set of culture and pattern. But both are bound only because they are controlled by the Habsburg family. And then if you take Italy, Germany, Venetia, Lombardy, Tunisia, Lombardy, Venetia, Parma, Modena, Tuscany, all these places, Galicia, Germany, Bohemians, Slavs, Romans, there is no political unity at all in any aspect. They are neither speaking any common language, neither following any religion, neither following any patterns which are similar in their lifetime. So then what is the common binding between all these people? Because they have a common boss. The common boss is a common emperor. The common emperor controls everybody. So the same taxation, same rules, which are made by the emperor, not by the people for themselves. They are forced to follow all these rules and regulations which are made by the emperor. These all things made them to be bound together. So this bounding together made them to think against a common enemy. This factor of common enmity or common problems which they are facing made them to think on the same guidelines towards to fight out against the ruler. This was the base, the foundation for the growth of a seed of nationalism. The seed of nationalism has been incepted because of the extreme powers which are being enforced on them by the dictators or the monarchies. This monarchy is bound various different cultural people. When the different cultural people are bound together and asked to perform in a similar way, that forces the people to think and have their own identity. Their own things have to be under their own religion, their own practices have to be respected. These all things change the pattern or the mindset of the people's thinking. So then, after the mindset of the people has been taken, the other major class which is in the existence of the European society, what is the other major section of the people coming under? Once if they are bound by some authority, the other major sections of the people, let us find out the different classes of people who live in Europe. What are the different categories of people that who stay in Europe? We have the major role played by the aristocracy, next the middle class. Let us first find out of the aristocracy. Aristocracy people have a common way of life. As I told you just now, there is no common way of life in these people's togetherness. They all are not together because they follow a common pattern, common religion or common language. They do not follow any of these things in common. They are only bound by the authorities of a common man. That man is a monarch and emperor. But when it comes to here in the aristocracy, you have a common way of life. We have a common owned estates. They have their own estates. Everybody often owns an estate. Generally, they have their own estates. Then, the language which is spoken by them is a French language. It used to be used for official purposes. So they used to speak official language, French language, for the diplomatic relationships. And they also have marriage bonds or marriage ties having between them each other. So within their own group, they used to get married their own daughters to the other people, where that they should maintain their own status of aristocracy people. And moving, peasantry was the other major class of the society which is found here. Then we have the growing of the middle class people in the bulk. So the aristocracy people are not very large in number, but very influential in society. They are in a very minor section of the community of the society. They are falling under very less pattern of society. They are coming under very few in number, in terms of numbers. But their influence has been very large. They own thousands of acres of land under their names of estates. That is the reason why they hold a large group of peasants. They used to force the peasants to work for bonded labor, slavery. They used to have a clear serfdom. They favored the federalism concept. They have the feudal lord concept. They used to act as a manor lords. So these all things made the people to think against them, to talk against them, to raise their voices against them. So how did the people get that courage to talk against them? Because peasants are working under the same community. They used to face the atrocities, whatever they used to do. So moving on to the other pattern. When it comes to the development of the middle classes, The role of the Industrial Revolution has never been neglected because the process of development of a common man started only with the Industrial Revolution. With the rapid changes that came out in the Industrial Revolution, revealed the fact that a common man also can do work in the industries, irrespective of the agricultural field, irrespective of the climatic conditions, irrespective of the problems which are the lack of rains, lack of seeds and all these things. He can work for a specific period of time and he can earn a fixed amount of salary which would raise their standard of living in their lives. These Industrial Revolution, rapid growth, trade across the countries. Initially, people used to trade within their own countries. But as the time passed on, people started to trade to the other countries, to the abroad nations. With that, their same trade has been expanded to various countries. The income of their families has been increased to a very large extent when it compared to the previous times. So these all things made it very clear the development of a common man standard to a middle class level, where they have done a hard work, they are being paid for that. So this kind of Industrial Revolution, the changes in the 19th century, which all made a new class to turn up. We have initially the nobles, the aristocrats, then a peasantry group. But in the middle, we got the middle class people who got benefited by the Industrial Revolution, who earned their incomes by the industrial rapid changes, who used to have trade rings with the other nations. So these all things made other group to step in, to have their own identity. So they got the courage to ask against the atrocities which are made by the aristocracy or the monarchy. These developments also favored for the rise of nationalism. As the aristocrats had a common culture, common way of living, commonly owned estates and all these things, in the same way, in the guidelines of the aristocratic lifestyle, the middle class people also started to own certain wealthy properties, have a systematic pattern of life, worshipping a common god, having a common language of conversation, having a common currency, having a trade links with other people. This also made the middle class people to gain a prominence important in the society. So these all things also gave way to rise of the favoritism of nationalism. Now, let us try to understand what is the concept of liberalism in connection with the French Revolution. What happened after French Revolution happened, and how can we get the concept of liberalism? Because the liberalism is for the first time we heard this word in the context of the French Revolution later. See, liberalism has having a word called liber. Liber is meaning word, Latin word, which means free. The word which is free. What is free? Are they giving anything free for us? Or is anything left out free? What is free? Freedom from certain things. Freedom from certain bondages. Freedom from certain kind of discriminations. From today onwards, you are free to follow your intention on whatever practice you want to do. You can do your occupation of your choice. Like that, certain freedoms are granted for us. That's the word meaning here, liberalism. Liber means free, which is taken from a Latin word called liber. And now, this liberalism emerged out of certain actions which are taken after the French Revolution, that is, the end of the certain privileges which are given for the nobles, the aristocrats, the specially privileged communities were all being banned, and there is no right to vote for a common man who is not rich. So this kind of all these things were being banned completely. The second is the universal suffrage. Suffrage is the authority of right to vote, right to participate in the political movements. The universal suffrage means undiscriminately to everybody the right to vote has been granted. This was one other intention of this one. But in actual practice, universal suffrage was not given for a larger time, because under the rule of Jacobin, only the male members were given the right to vote. Other than that, prior to that, we have the governments who are National Assembly people, where they made a discrimination between the members who had property and who do not own property. Or at least we should have a taxpayer of a common man's 3 days salary. So these kind of discriminations made people to feel that they are not completely associated with the changes. And women were completely banned from the right to vote. They were not given the right to vote till the end of the 20th century. So whole long of the 20th century starting to the ending, The women were doing a lot of movements to get out or to get themselves recognized and to get the right to vote. That are the major things which are being done. And the federation of 39 states having 11 different kinds of taxes has been streamlined. Different types of currencies of 30 different types of currencies used to be existent. That all were shortlisted and only two were made formal. And the union of Prussian states, of 39 Prussian states, was made as a union of trade union called Zollverein, which was initiative of Napoleon's rule. These all things made people to think of the new ideas, new concepts, change of the old patterns. So let's have a brief recap of what is liberalism. Liberalism is derived from a French Latin word called liber, meaning free. We got this concept of freedom from certain actions which have been initiated after French Revolution. That is the end of the special privileges which are given to certain classes. Universal suffrage given by Jacobin to a certain period of time. No property has been associated, or no property, men and women are not given any kind of freedom of right to vote initially before the Jacobins government came to power. Then we have women fought for various movements and struggles to get themselves recognized, to get voting rights. Federation of 39 states in Prussia has emerged out and wash out of 11 different kinds of taxes into two streamlined taxes, and a common currency has been issued. And also we have Zollverein, the union of 39 states formed in Prussia, in which the contribution of Napoleon was really very high. Now let us move on to the new conservatism 1815. In 1815, what happened? Why did the new conservatism come up? The actual thing is, Napoleon came to power in 1799. From 1799 to 1804, Napoleon was a constitutional monarch. From 1804 onwards, Napoleon declared himself as an absolute monarch. After he turned as an absolute monarch, he wanted to redraw the map of France with joining the other nations. So he waged many wars, he occupied many countries. After he occupied many countries and he destroyed many kingdoms, he was almost victorious in almost every war. In 1813, the countries like Britain, Russia, Prussia and Italy, Austria joined together and tried to defeat Napoleon in 1813. They were successful to defeat, but Napoleon left back. Again in 1815, Napoleon came back with certain amount of army and made an attempt to destroy the kings. But in 1815, completely Napoleon was defeated and imprisoned, and he was given a punishment to stay away from the kingdom in a very far off place, island. The island name is Saint Helena. So with this, it is very clear Napoleon lost his entire ground. In 1815, the complete hold on the France was lost. Yes, he had many followers who are inspired just by the name of Napoleon. We are not asking how many are influenced now. Really, practically, Napoleon lost the entire powers which are for him on the land of Europe in France. So after Napoleon was defeated, the powers who came together to defeat Napoleon formed as an union, as a group, and had their meeting at a place that is the capital of Austria, headed or hosted by Archduke Metternich, has called up for the meeting to sign up a peace treaty called the Treaty of Vienna. That was happened in the year 1815. So in the Treaty of Vienna, the leaders of Britain, Russia, Prussia and Austria collectively came to defeat Napoleon and joined their hands to restore or recollect the mistakes which were done by Napoleon. So let's see what did they do. The modern army, Napoleon gave a good role model setup for the autocratic monarchies. So they studied the success points of Napoleon. One is, we have a well-planned modern army The second is an efficient bureaucracy. Third, the dynamic economy. Fourth, the abolition of feudalism and serfdom. Five, strengthening autocratic monarchies in Europe. These are the key observations to hold the meeting of Congress of Vienna. The actual discussions in this meeting was to eliminate the moves which are made by Napoleon. They want to destroy the mark of Napoleon from the history of Europe, which is actually practically impossible. But they studied the factors which led for the success of Napoleon. And then they were able to understand that a modern army is a must for any ruler, any monarch. So a well-equipped modern army is mandatory. So they decided we would go ahead with a modern army. An efficient bureaucracy is also a very top priority requirement to have a structured system in the nation. A dynamic economy, a good economy will always bring confidence and the capacities to buy the things, buy the material, hold the soldiers and everything. So a dynamic economy is also required for them. And the abolition of feudalism and serfdom were some of the key steps to attract the people, to bring confidence in the people that they also belong to the same effect of the nationism and they want to connect them to the common people. So these are all the major things which made Napoleon to be a great leader. Why Napoleon today also had many lakhs of fans is because of his efforts which were done prior to this. After this is done, the strengthening of autocratic monarchies is the main vision of Metternich. Metternich wants this concept to be go in depth in Europe and he wants to replace all the people who were being dethroned by Napoleon. The next step taken by the committee or the Treaty of Vienna, Conversation of Vienna, Conversation meeting was to restore all the people, kings, who are being dethroned by Napoleon. So we have Austrian Chancellor Duke Metternich hosting the Treaty of Vienna. Representatives of Britain, Russia, Prussia and Austria attended here. And the autocratic, new autocratics, why do we call them as new conservationism or new conservatism is, conservatism is actually synchronizing the things with the old patterns, following the set of patterns which are followed from the olden days. They do not get changed or modified with the new changes, new requirements, new themes, new modern era changes. So, setting back to the old pattern and forcing the people to follow the old pattern. The new conservatism is also something which want to have all the ideologies of the old conservatism under a new brand name. That is a new conservatism. What did they want to do follow actually? That is, in the autocratic, they want to have no tolerance to people who talk against them, who raise their voices against them, who do not follow the guidelines or the ideologies which are given by the dictator. Then, they are saying no to criticism. Any criticism will not be heard by them. If you raise your voice and criticize the king, you will be beheaded. This kind of strong rules they want to impose. And they also want to have dissent, dissatisfaction. Any kind of dissatisfaction will not be accepted. You have to abide yourself for the laws which are passed by the king. And legitimacy, no legal sanctions of anything. The authority of the king is final and the final words are to be followed without any break. If you do not listen and if you do not follow any such kind of things, you are going to face the trials. These all things are made very serious. And the censorship, newspapers, public debates, public talking, public telecast or anything has been completely under the censor. Even if you use any word against the ruler, you will be tortured. These kind of things are branding themselves to be as a new conservatives. And when we move on to the other revolutionary movements which initiated the process was many people turned underground because of this kind of efforts made by the new autocratic rulers who came to power after 1815's Treaty of Vienna, where Napoleon's entire kingdoms were being pulled back by the group headed by Duke And then when all the people, those who want to fight, were being forced to go to underground, Mazzini, a young guy of 24 years old, who was completely unhappy with the existing system, he wanted to bring change and develop the spirit of nationalism in Europe. He started a secret forces called Carbonari, a secret alliance, secret groups called Carbonaris. So this Carbonaris, his intention was, according to Giuseppe Mazzini, natural units of mankind are nations. Nations are nothing but the naturally formed units. So it's not necessary to get anyone's approval to be a nation. You need not fight with anybody to be a nation. This was the intention of Giuseppe Mazzini. So he started the secret agent groups called Carbonari to have independent Italy. That was his dream. This ideology of Giuseppe Mazzini was looked in a different view by Metternich. He gave a tagline for him, and he considered him as a serious threat to the kingdoms what they have restored. That is, the most dangerous enemy of our social order, the new order which we plan to create by restoring the old people who are being displaced by Napoleon. We have a new conservatism policy. We have zero tolerance towards criticism. We have clear-cut censorship. We have all these things. So with all these things, basics, we want this man to be out of the system. But he is a common enemy for all of us because his ideology is completely opposite to our created social order. His remarks made Mazzini a prominent person in the history and also increased the role of Mazzini to fight for Italy. The words are, most dangerous enemy of our social order. Metternich quoted these words. So what happened with this? So the journey started with liberalism, where the concept of freedom has entered into the brains of people, the end of special privileges to all people, universal suffrage has been the common aim, equal rights to vote to all people, then no special privileges for any rich people or no special denial for any poor people. Jacobin granted this one, gave for all men right to vote. Women were not given any right to vote till the later part of the 20th century. So women started to fight to get their rights. Then the Federation of 39 states, Napoleon made a fantastic changes in the administration, in the revenue sources, and also in the war skills and all these things. Is one of the major steps which the 1815 new conservatives also do not like to touch them was, it was a very good step taken by Napoleon in regards to the forming of a union group of 39 states named as Zollverein, and a single tax, single currency, everything was streamlined. And later, after studying the new success story of Napoleon, what made Napoleon to be very successful? A modern army, an efficient bureaucracy, a dynamic economy, the abolition of feudal serfdom, strength of the autocratic monarchies in Europe, and the British, Russia, Prussia, Austria came together, kingdoms collectively defeated Napoleon. That is really a fantastic point which we all need to highlight in that one. In order to defeat a one person kingdom, the all groups have joined together and defeated them. And it was under the leadership of Duke Metternich who hosted the Treaty of Vienna in 1815. And the old kings were restored, who were replaced or who were being removed from power or defeated by Napoleon. And after the new conservatives came, they were completely autocratic. They followed the zero tolerance, no to criticism, and dissent or legitimacy or censorship, all has been imposed. Many people turned to be secret or silent after these efforts which were made by the new conservatives. Mazzini started the Carbonari. Natural units are mankind, nations. This is the ideology of Giuseppe Mazzini. But this ideology of Giuseppe Mazzini was looked in a very dangerous and a serious threat to the created order by them, by Metternich. In his own words, he quoted him that the most dangerous enemy of our existing social order, or the order which we planned, is Giuseppe Mazzini. That is the reason why there has been a ban kept and imposed on all the Carbonari forces which have been in existence, and they were tortured if you have any secret forces. So these are certain effects which gave rise for the outbreak of the revolts. So let's find out what are the other major outbreaks of the revolts in the next part.
If you like this video, please give a thumbs up. Please subscribe to our channel to get more videos on CBSE syllabus.